to begin, we are going to ask Sister Daphne to open us in prayer. Rejoice, ye pure in heart, rejoice, give thanks and sing. Your festal banner wave on high, the cross of Christ your King. Rejoice, 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 give thanks and sing. With voice as full and strong as ocean surge in praise, send forth the sturdy hymns of old, the psalms of ancient days. Rejoice, 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 give thanks and sing. With all the angels choirs, with all the saints on earth, pour out the strains of joy and bliss to wrap their noblest mirth. Rejoice, 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 give thanks and sing. Yes, on through life's long path, still chanting as we go, from you to age by night and day, in gladness and in woe. Rejoice, 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 give thanks and sing. Praise him who reigns on high, the Lord whom we adore, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, one God forevermore. Rejoice, 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 give thanks and sing. Amen. We want to sing a couple of these, old hymnals. 430. Joy by and by. 430. Oh, there'll be joy when the work is done, joy when the reapers gather home, bringing the sheaves at set of sun to the new Jerusalem. Joy, joy, there'll be joy by and by, joy, joy, where the joys never die. When the workers gather home, sweet are the songs that we hope to sing, grateful the thanks our hearts shall bring, praising forever Christ our King in the new Jerusalem. Joy, joy, there be joy by and by, joy, joy, where the joys never die, joy, joy, for the day draweth nigh, when the workers gather home. Pure are the joys that await us there, many the golden mansions fair. Jesus himself doth them prepare in the new Jerusalem. Joy, joy, there'll be joy by and by, joy, joy, where the joys never die, joy, joy, where the joys one more we could sing. Five more. It's so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know the said the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him all. Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge me neath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Yes, it's sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Yes, it's sweet to trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply taking life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that thou art with me, will be with me till the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. Amen. Will you better come and help me sing it? There is a land of pure delight where bliss eternal reigns. In finite day excludes the night and the pleasures banish pain. We are traveling to Emmanuel's land. We soon shall hear the trumpets
sound, and soon we shall with Jesus reign, and never, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. And soon we shall with Jesus reign, and never, never part again. There everlasting spring abides, and never a thing flows, and but a little space divides this heavenly land from us. We are traveling to Emmanuel's land. We soon shall hear the trumpet sound, and soon we shall with Jesus reign, and never, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. And soon we shall with Jesus reign, and never, never part again. Could we but stand where Moses stood, and view the landscape all, not all this world pretended good could ever charm us more. We are traveling to Emmanuel's land. We soon shall hear the trumpet sound, and soon we shall with Jesus reign, and never, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. What? Never part again. No, never part again. And soon we shall with Jesus reign, and never, never part again.
Amen. Amen. At this time we'll hear a little history from Sister Daphne.
You know, it's always a joy to come into the presence of God. Even though we are few in numbers, I am so enjoying this. And remember, God has promised that where two or three are gathered, he is in the midst to bless. You know, and that song, Never Part Again, it really touches my heart. Because I want to make an announcement today, now, you know, a few of us here, that I will be leaving, by God's grace, Trinidad soon, right? And, you know, when I think of the time when we'll never part again, because it is with mixed feelings. You know, I'm happy to go, and I'm still sad to go, you know? So it is with mixed feelings. So this song means a lot to me, that soon we will be where we will never part again. And I just want to say, as I stand here to bring this history, that I pray that we would all be faithful, because there are conditions for this never parting again, you know? We can't just come to church and feel that we'll never part again. We must have that personal relationship with Jesus, that saving relationship, and then we can lay hold on that promise of never parting again. It is also a joy this morning to stand here when I think of the pioneers, because if it wasn't for them, where would we be? I often wonder, you know, if it wasn't for this Adventist church, because my family was strong Catholics, where would I be? I thank God that I belong to the family of God. And I'm sure all of us thank him for that. Now, this is just a little history of the church. Well, of course, we know that the, as we will say, Adventism was birthed in Coover, right? And it started right across there. Anybody knows the Hat and Hand? I know Maureen will know. German might know, right? You know the Hat and Hand as well? You know, right, right, the building, right, right. So that is where it first started. They say in 1894, we had Elder and Mrs. Flowers. They were the pioneers. They came and they moved to Coover, where they started an evangelistic effort in the Hat and Hand Lodge. They rented that for 26 evenings at $1 per evening. What can we get for a dollar now? At, you know. Yeah. All right. So there was great rejoicing as the brethren sang together, "Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it." And I would like us to stand now and sing that hymn as we take our minds back to that day in the year 1894. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. And we thank God for the blood of Jesus that covers us, that does everything for us without the blood. So we're going to stand now and sing "Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it." What's the number? Right, Sister Lois Willie, that's all. She's the lark here this morning. You're singing the old one, right?
Which one?
Redeemed, 237.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through his infinite mercy. His child and
seated. So we've been redeemed and we his children forever. So that was the first hymn the Advent believers sang in Coover. So that should really mean something for us, you know. This at the close of the effort, 6 persons decided to meet the gospel requirement for baptism. There were Cox, Simeon, George, which I believe Maureen is, not this George, is Floret and the family. The mother, right, they were George, right. St. Clair Phipps, which I think is that Phipps, the singer. I think it's his family. What's his name? Philip Phipps? Whitney, right, right, Winkley. Charlotte Pierce, which is not the Charlotte Pierce that we know, Maureen. And Jeremiah O'Brien, which is my stepmother's cousin. Now, after the Coover evangelistic effort, they moved to Port of Spain, And we know that some of the pioneers died of yellow fever, right? And one of them was Elder Flowers. He's buried in the La Perouse Cemetery in Port of Spain. Okay? But they said his wife was a courageous woman, and she decided to carry on, although he died while he was doing an evangelistic series. She decided to carry on the series. And eventually she came back to Trinidad, and they say it was a source of joy for the believers, you know, to greet her again. And I read somewhere where she used to stand up on a little kerosene tin or something, so to preach, covered with paper and that kind of thing. They didn't have all this sort of posh thing that we have, right? Anyway, God was with his people and the work went forward. Now, we have one who came, they sent Elder Webster, that's the street that I live in, Webster Street. They sent Elder Webster to superintend the Adventist work in the island, and he called a meeting in Exchange Village, which is that village across, behind the grocery and so on there, for those of you who not from Coover and don't know. That's Exchange behind there, right? So he called a meeting in Exchange Village, and that was to organize the first Seventh-day Adventist Church in Trinidad. After explaining the duties and so on, the church was organized and they accepted the people into the church due to baptism. And there were how many of them? About 17, I think. And if anybody remember that young lady who used to be here and then she went to Carolina. She died, Corinne. Her family here, she has family who were among, well, I said the pioneers, right? Huh? No. Yes. Her family. I think the Thorns were her family. Well, of course, we know the Carnarvons, Maggie Carnarvon and Pierce, which was Charlotte Pierce's family. Some of us know Charlotte and Jui and Tante Susie, Sister Williams. They came. Well, she wasn't among those, but her ancestors came from that. So they had a baptism, they had communion. And you hear when? Within 3 months, the group was ready for baptism. I'm not saying anything more. 3 months of studying the Word of God. Okay. And then from here, this was the pivotal role. They went to Indian Walk, they went to Port of Spain and to different places. San Fernando, Tunapuna, and we know we have all these children all over Trinidad now, right? But as we stand here today celebrating the 127th anniversary of the Seventh-day Adventist message in Trinidad and Tobago, I'm sure that we are all very happy to be part of that celebration this morning. So I just want to encourage all of us to keep faithful and always to be happy to know that this is where it started, you know, and we have to be examples now for those who are coming behind. May all who come behind us find us faithful. Thank you.
Thank you, Sister Daphne, for that piece of history, and thanks, Sister Richens, for providing us with that history. We're going to introduce Elder Selwyn Hewitt, you know, to break a few words of encouragement to us. But before we do that, we're going to sing. How sweet are the tidings that greet the pilgrim's ear. Number 442. You all want to stand up? Believe when you stand up, you sing. Yeah. Let us stand.
How sweet are the tidings that greet the pilgrim's ear as he wanders in exile from home. Soon, soon will the Savior in glory appear
go when the Savior comes to reign. The mercy of grace where the pilgrims sleep shall be open as wide as before. And millions that sleep in the mighty deep shall live undisturbed once more. He is coming, coming, coming soon, I know, coming back to this earth again. And the weary pilgrims will to glory go when the Savior comes to reign. There we'll meet near to pardon, a happy Eden home, sweet songs of redemption we'll sing. From the north, from the south, all the ransom shall come and worship our heavenly King. He is coming, coming, coming soon, I know, coming back to this earth again. And the weary pilgrim will to glory go when the Savior comes to reign. Hallelujah, amen, hallelujah again. Soon and faithful we all shall be there. Oh, be watchful, be hopeful, be joyful till then, and a crown of bright glory we'll wear. He is coming, coming, coming soon, I know, coming back to this earth again. And the weary pilgrims will to glory go when the Savior comes to reign. Amen.
Morning, church. I want to thank the prayer leader, Sister Veronica Lewis, for inviting me to say a few words this morning. You know, on a Wednesday morning, we start to have a little prayer service. So people who need prayer, they could come to the church just as they are, whether they're working or not, they could just come as they are and we solicit prayers. Praying for people is important, and when people come for prayers and they are prayed for, they leave here rejoicing. But this morning, Sister Vero asked me to come and say a few words. We're celebrating the church anniversary today. This is the date that the church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, began in Trinidad and Tobago on this day in 127 years ago. And before I came here, I was talking to God. I was giving God thanks and praise for the advancement of his work, because if it wasn't for that body that started the movement, I would not be here. And so there's a lot we ought to give God thanks for, especially when we see how the work has progressed from 1895 to now. Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, through the righteousness of Jesus Christ, I come into your presence, and may your Holy Spirit edify us this day. In Jesus' name. You see, the psalmist David said in Psalms 104, Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. So from 1895 to now, there's a number of generations. So that if we say a generation is about 40 years, that would be three generations. And if we say a generation is 20 years, that would be about five to six generations. So the truth of God has endured. The truth of God has endured, and his word have declared it, that his truth will endure to all generations. So God's truth will always be. And because of truth, we are who we are today. So we thank the pioneers. We heard Sister Daphne talk about Elder Flowers. We heard her spoke about Elder Webster, and forming the first organization, the organized church. It began here. And the first song that was sung, Redeem, How I Love to Proclaim It. What a wonderful song it is. And if we were to take that song to our hearts, we will understand why it is we have to give God thanks. So this morning, I have entitled this little discourse as Six Reasons We Should Give God Thanks. Six Reasons We Should Give God Thanks. And we must give God thanks for a number of things. But if we look at Psalms 103, 1 to 5 will encompass things that we ought to give God thanks, and it would reflect on the journey of the church, how the church have moved from 1895 to now. There are certain things that the believers, we all believe. And when we believe in these things, we give God thanks. We praise him, we give him thanks. And this is the only way that the church could survive, is when we give God thanks. Psalm 100 tells us we must come into his courts with thanksgiving and praise. We must give him thanks for all things, because we are the sheep of his pasture. We didn't make ourselves, etc. So let us examine Psalms 103 and see why it is we should give God thanks, and why the church endured to today because of these elements that are in Psalms 103. So the first thing it says is that, bless the Lord, O my soul, all that is within me, bless his holy name, bless the Lord. So the object of praising God is God. He is the object of our worship. Bless the Lord, O my soul. You see, when we praise God and bless his holy name, we are praising God and blessing his holy name for his beneficence and mercy and goodness. You see, it's only a redeemed person could bless God and thank God for his mercy, his goodness. You see, we are not contented with the acts of God only, but we are praising God for the character of God. We are praising God for the character, God's character. You know, it is he that has made us, yes. We are the sheep of his pasture, yes. But his character, it declares the Lord is good. The Lord is good. That's a character of God. He is good. He is merciful. His mercy is everlasting. So when we praise God for his character of love. And in Psalms 103, it shows us how we should praise God. We should praise God personally. Bless the Lord, O my soul. So this is not a cooperating and you're joining with people to praise God. It says what? Bless the Lord, O my soul. So it is personal. You must have that personal relationship with God to give him praise and to give him thanks. And whenever we do that, this is why the psalmist David put it in that way. It is not a work to be handed over to the choir or to the congregation. It is to be our own personal praise unto God. You know, so you get up in the morning and you give God praise. You don't put on the radio and the TV and you hear a choir sing and you hear the preacher preach and you say you praise God. Other people praise God for you. But you must be personally involved in praising God. And the believers long ago knew that. That is why the church exists today. Because they had that personal relationship with God. They could have praised God, and by praising God, they were strengthened and they were encouraged to spread the word, to redeem how I love to proclaim it. So they went about proclaiming the redemption work. And then praising God is a spiritual thing. Eh? It's a personal thing. It's a spiritual thing. It is to be from the heart. It is from the mind. In whenever you talk, in music, you know, nothing, you see, everything else counts for nothing unless you praise God, unless you give God thanks. Counts for nothing. You must be able in that frame of mind to give, and it must be wholehearted, because the psalmist David say, all that is within me, praise the Lord. All that is within me, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, all. Body, soul, spirit, your subconscious, your mind, your imagination, you know, all that is within me must give God praise and thanks. So, you know, we get up in the morning and the first thing, our whole soul, our whole body must be able to say, praise be to God, I'm alive today. It is through God we live, we move, we have our being. And with that energy, we would be able to proclaim the redemption story as the pioneers before. And the church will continue to grow from strength to strength, and it will never finish. The church will always be. The church will always be, so long as we proclaim the redemption story and give God praise and thanks. And there's a purpose. There's a purpose for praising God. Forget not all his benefits. When we praise God, we should not forget his benefits. Now, I will want to read Deuteronomy 8, 11 to 18. Because we tend to forget his benefits. So permit me to read Deuteronomy chapter 8. I hope we walk with our devices, our Bibles, so we could share. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 11. It says here, beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God. So the same thing the psalmist David said, forget not all his benefits. Hear what Moses says. Beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God in not keeping his commandment and his judgment and his statute, which I command thee this day. Lest when thou hast eaten and art full, and hast built goodly houses and dwell therein, and when thy herds and thy flocks multiply, and thy silver and thy gold is multiplied, and all that thou hast is multiplied, then thy heart be lifted up, and thou forget the Lord thy God. You know, As we start to have money and house and property and all them things, because God has multiplied your blessings. He says, and don't forget, your heart get lifted up, and don't forget the Lord thy God, which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage, who led thee through that great and terrible wilderness, wherein were fiery serpents and scorpions and drought, where there was no water, who brought thee forth water out of the rock of flint, who fed thee in the wilderness with manna, which thy fathers knew not, that he might humble thee and that he might prove thee to do thee good in the latter end. So therefore, my brothers and sisters, Moses was telling the people, you're going to be prosperous, you're going to benefit because God is going to multiply your blessings. But when God multiplied your blessings and you could eat and you could drink and you have property and you have all these things, forget not how the Lord has led. You know, to come home now with the church, you know, God has led this church in a particular way from since 1895 in Trinidad and Tobago. And we are prosperous now. God has multiplied the church. The church has multiplied. We have numerous members. We have buildings. We have colleges. We have educational institute. We have hospital institute. We have health institute. We have a multiple of things because God has blessed us. God has blessed the church from since 1895 to now. We have conferences. We have union. We have divisions. We have a lot of things in place. But my brothers and sisters, some of us have forgotten how the Lord has led. And what the psalmist David is saying, forget not his benefits. And he went through a few of the things. The first thing he said, forget not all it, who forgiveth all thy iniquities. So the first thing that the psalmist David said that we should remember is that God has forgiven us of our iniquities. And as a church, we forget that God has forgiven us. So we don't forgive others because we forget God has forgiven us. And the only reason why the spiritual church of Israel exists and is forever moving forward is because members of Christ's church know what it is to be forgiven and to forgive others. That is why the church moves forward. You see, the truth will always endure. And the truth about it is forgiveness. God forgives, we ought to forgive. And the church will move forward. And then the second thing he said, because you must remember that God said, as far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed our transgressions from us. My brothers and sisters, what I'm saying on this morning is that God has removed our transgression. There is a prayer that says, forgive us our sins, our trespasses, our debt, as, the operative word is as, we forgive. You know, sometimes I have to pray, Lord, forgive me of my sins and help me to forgive others as you forgive. Sometimes that word, as we forgive, is so frightening. It's so frightening because I know sometimes the whole thing in our mind, in our heart, in our soul, and for years we walk with it, 20, 40 years, and if we were in the days of the pioneers and we were to live that kind of age, some of us may be walking with things that happened since 1895, 1896. But thank God for his mercies and his grace that he has forgiven us and he has removed our trespasses. And we ought to pray, as you have forgiven us, help us to forgive others, right? And then the second thing that he mentioned in the psalm is for the healing of the soul. For you have healed me from all my diseases. You have healed me from all my diseases. Do not forget that God has healed you from the disease of guilt and shame when coming to sin. That is the disease he is speaking about, or no? Because whenever we are forgiven, that shame and that guilt that we walk with, that is removed. We walk with a confidence that God has forgiven me. People could say what they want. God has forgiven me. So that shame and that guilt is being removed by the blood of Jesus Christ. So when he says, you have forgiven me from all my diseases, the chief thing is guilt and shame of sin, because that is a disease that when we walk with, all other diseases come upon you. Physical disease, some people get all kind of things, right? I wouldn't mention the kind of sickness that comes upon people when they walk with shame and guilt. It kills people, shame and guilt. So therefore, God has healed us from the shame and guilt of sin. You see, it would be poor salvation if we did not follow forgiveness. For without forgiveness, we should soon be back to our sins again. Therefore, we need this healing of the soul. And you know it is promised in Isaiah 1:6-16, come, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, etc., I will make it white as snow. Right? So he removes all them shame and them guilt, and he heals you. He makes you white. Makes you white as snow, right? Ezekiel 36:25-27 will tell us of God healing and restoring. And the third thing he talks about, he has redeemed me from a life of destruction. Psalms 103, those first five verses, the very third thing he mentioned that we should not forget is redemption, the redemption story. The penalty in this life is averted. He has redeemed us from a life of destruction. Thank God for Jesus Christ. Thank God for redemption. For God himself left heaven to come on earth to die so we could be redeemed. He paid that ransom for us in dying on the cross. He shed his blood for the remission of sins, and we are redeemed. The other day I spoke about redemption through the precious blood of Jesus Christ at a prayer and fast. And it spoke to redeeming us from our foreparents' teachings and all these things, idol worship and other doctrines that we believe, and the behavior and attitude. You know, we walk with it and we say, my mother could do it, my father could do it, therefore I could do it. A life of destruction. But thank God, we are redeemed from a life of destruction, and we are on the way to eternal life. We have eternal life in Christ. You see, the comfort of God's Spirit, power to witness for Christ, victory over sin, hope, bright hope of eternal life, all these are His. His life is redeemed from destruction. Your life is redeemed from destruction. And we now sang a song, redeem, how I love to proclaim it. Redeem by the blood of the Lamb. We must not forget this. That is why the church has triumphed over the years. Because the church is filled with a redeemed people. We are a redeemed people. And when we pass on this redemption story to our children, and we proclaim it to our neighbors, and we proclaim it wherever we go, then the redemption story will triumph, because truth is unto all generations. That is why we give God thanks. So, and then the fourth thing he tells us that we should be grateful for, and we should bless the name of the Lord for. He crowneth us with loving kindness and tender mercies. Do you experience the kindness of God, the tender mercies of God daily? I could tell you I experience the love of God daily. Could tell you that from my heart, we experience the love of God daily. From the time you get up in the morning, it's an act of the love of God. I always go back to as you get up in the morning. It is the love of God. You are resurrected, you are sleeping, you didn't know anything, but God called you in the morning and you are up. That's the love of God. And this life that he giveth you for the day, you commit it to him. That whatever you say and do and whatever how God leads, it is for his name's sake, it is for his honor, it is for his glory. So we thank God for his mercies. We thank God for his loving kindness. Every day. And I want to go back to the church from 1895 to now. The mercies of God have been upon his church. The love of God has been shed upon his church. The church is organized. The church is moving forward because of the love of God and the mercies of God. That is why we got to be thankful for God's love and for his mercy. For it says here that if we were to look at the prodigal son, he is forgiven, he is healed, he is redeemed, he is crowned, he got a ring, he put on the robe, he has shoes. There's a big feast. The Lord is compassionate. The Lord is gracious. The Lord is slow to anger. So we thank God for his mercies, and because of his kindness and tender mercies, the church moves forward. And it will continue to move forward because of God's kindness and love. So we give God thanks. Bless his holy name. And then the fifth thing he mentioned that the pioneers and the church experience is the goodness of God for satisfaction with good. Because it says what? He satisfies us with his righteousness. And Christ's righteousness prevails. It is because we are covered with the righteousness of Jesus Christ, the church prevails. So, the church is moving forward under the covering of the righteousness of Jesus Christ. So when the text says, who satisfy thy mouth with good things? Who satisfy thy mouth with good things? And the good things that he satisfies us with is the righteousness of Jesus Christ. That we could speak our mouth, whatever things are good and true and honest and of a good report, we could speak about these things because we are covered with the righteousness of Jesus Christ. God satisfies our desire for righteousness. He satisfies our desire for goodness, right? And because we have a desire for goodness, because we have a desire for righteousness, God satisfies that desire. This is why Jesus Christ himself said, in praying, as a prayer committee, as a prayer band, as the prayer people, the Bible says, whatever you desire, the desire, it says, whatever you desire and you ask in Jesus' name, the Father will grant it unto you. So therefore, prayers have to have a desire. You just can't pray and utter words. It must have a desire. And your desire is for righteousness. Our desire is for righteousness. The church desires for righteousness. And God satisfies it in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. He covers you with the righteousness of Jesus Christ. So that satisfaction, that desire, is being satisfied in Jesus Christ. So therefore, He satisfies your desire for good thing. And the last thing he says, don't mind, the whole psalm itself is a psalm of praise, is a psalm of, and there is no supplication in this psalm. Eh? Psalm 103, 1 to 16, there is no supplication. It is only praise and thanks for his compassion. And if you look in the church hymnal, the Seventh-day Adventist hymnal, at 711, hymn 711, you will see the psalm with some additional things on it. 711. But the last thing in verse 1 to 5 is what I'm dealing with, is he renews our strength from day to day. The youth of the soul is renewed. For he says, who satisfy thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. He renews your strength. Isaiah 40, 30, 31 tells us, I'm going to read this. Isaiah 40, 30 to 31 will tell us. Let us look at Isaiah. Isaiah 40, 30, the two last texts in the Bible, it says what? Even the youths shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew thy strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint, because they wait on the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul. All that is within me, bless your holy name, because you renew my strength. You renew my strength, right? So the outward man may decay, but the inward man shall be renewed day by day. Day by day, we shall be renewed. So my brothers and sisters, as we look at this passage of scripture from Psalms 103, 1 to 5, 1 to 6, we recognize what we are thankful for as a church. As a church, we are thankful. We are grateful for the way the Lord has led. We are thankful, we are grateful for the organization that has moved from 17 persons to over 60,000 persons in Trinidad and Tobago. We are thankful that the church has grown to such an extent that we have a lot of institutions that benefit the members and the wider society at large. We have educational facilities from early childhood to university, so that our people could be educated to a degree that they will benefit in all spheres of life. And not only for our members, but our institutions are open for all. Open for all, because God is no respecter of persons. For he has redeemed all of us from every tribe, from every tongue, from every language, from every nation, declaring that we are one redeemed people in Jesus Christ. And we all will shout, salvation belongeth to God. Salvation belongeth to the Lamb of God. All because of God's love for us. God's love for us came to Trinidad and Tobago in message through Elder Fowler, through Elder Webster, and the love of God is triumphing, is victorious throughout Trinidad and Tobago, even to today. So my brothers and sisters, the love of God is manifested through Jesus Christ, who died for us while we were yet sinners. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him will not perish, but have eternal life. What is your desire? What is your desire for the future? Would you like to have eternal life, to fellowship with God, to fellowship with Jesus Christ, to fellowship with Elder Webster, with Elder Fowler, to fellowship with the pioneers, to fellowship with the prophets, the priests, to fellowship with the redeemed people of God? What is your desire? Would you like to fellowship with your lost loved one? Would you like to fellowship with someone that you knew? Then, my brothers and sisters, I ask you, I beg of you, receive Jesus Christ. He is the answer. There is a blessed hope in Jesus Christ, for he is coming again. And when he comes again, he comes for the redeemed people of God, those who die in Christ. And if you die in Christ, you will be called forth. And you will be called forth to eternal life. But if you die out of Christ, you'll be called forth but to damnation. What is your choice? My choice is Jesus Christ. May God bless you. May the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ be with you all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you very much, Elder Hewitt, for that word. And you know, I thank Elder Hewitt because it was this morning, you know, the Spirit say, why I don't call Elder Hewitt and ask him to say a few words? And right away I just called Elder Hewitt because I had nothing, you know, I just say, and he quickly agreed. Praise God and thank you for your ministry, Elder Hewitt, and for your words. And so, we're going to have a prayer session, and then we would sing. I hope everyone, I saw one very, this said he's a blessed hope. So we're going to sing Sweet Hour of Prayer, and we are going to, Sweet Hour, I know, number 478, and then we will ask Sister Jocelyn to pray for us. We're going to pray for the church, thanking God for bringing us all the way down to 127 years. All right? So, okay, let us stand. We're going to just sing one stanza of Sweet Hour of Prayer, 478. Sweet Hour of Prayer, Sweet Hour.
Listen to such a beautiful and spirit-filled sermon, you know, let's bow our heads and let us Give God all the praise and all the honor and the glory that is due to his high, holy, and exalted name. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, heaven and earth are full of your glory, O Lord Most High. Lord, I ask you, Lord, to forgive each one of us for every sin that we may have committed in thoughts, word, deed, and in action, O God. Lord, forgive us for negligence or carelessness and a shortcoming, Lord, for it's you alone that we have sinned against. Lord, we want to thank you, Lord, for the journey. It has been rigorous, but Lord, you have brought us truly, dear Father, to 127 years, dear God. Lord, we give you all the praise, and we give you all the honor, and we give you all the glory this morning, oh God. You said we are two and three are gathered together. You are always in the midst to bless. Lord, bless and keep us. Forgive us for every sin that we have committed in thoughts, word, deed, and in action, oh God. Lord, we have failed you, but you are unfailing, God. You keep running after us, oh God. And Lord, we want to thank you for our church members, our elders, our leaders, oh God. Lord, we want to thank you for our young people, dear Father, who have become cold and indifferent, oh God. And those who have left the faith, Lord, put your loving arms and bring them back to the fold again, dear God. Is there anything too hard for you to do, oh God? Nothing is too hard for you to do. Each one of us have needs this morning, oh God. Lord, each of us, our faith has varied, and so is our need. But you said if we have faith as a mustard seed, that you would say, mountain, remove, and it shall be removed. Lord, remove every mountain out of our lives, oh God, and help those mountains become stepping stone, dear God, that we be able to encourage each other. Help us to love one another, oh God, for love for fellow men, dear Jesus. Lord, we thank God for our prayer intercessory group, dear God. Lord, I want to thank you for each member, dear God. Lord, we have fail you, but Lord, you are unfailing, and we want to thank you, Lord, for being with us. Lord, mold us and make us into the person that you want us to be. Help each one of us to have that personal relationship with you, oh God. Lord, I beg you, Lord, to bathe us from the crown of our heads to the sole of our feet. What can wash our sins away? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make us white again? Nothing but your blood, oh God. Lord, each one of us rededicate our life this morning, oh God. We are all yours, sold out for you, God. Lord, let the fire be in us and we'll tell somebody about you. Let our lives be living examples, oh God, so that people will see Christ, the Son of the living God, reigning and dwelling within us. Take away self and selfishness, God, and help us, dear Father, that we would have your character, God. There's nothing too hard for you to do. Isaiah 41 says, fear not, for you are going to be with us. Be not dismayed, for you are God. Lord, you said that you are going to strengthen us. We need your strength. You said that you are going to help us. Please help us in this unprecedented time, oh God. We are living, we are dwelling in a grand and awful time. But God, you have been there through all this time, and you are not going to leave us because you promised. And each one of us who are bowing our heads there, God, please, Father, put us in your hands of righteousness and keep us there, and help us that we're able to encourage each other. Lord, bless us and keep us in the name and the blood of Jesus forever. What I failed to ask, fail not to grant it unto us, for Christ's sake. Amen. Amen.
Okay, well, I thank you all for being here this morning. It was a very spirit-filled, and it was good. It was good. And so, as we close, we are going to sing. We're going to sing, I Saw One, sad, and if you could find it there for 441, well, you'll have to come and help me sing that. 441. Right. 441. So, this was a time well spent for me. It was good, and I thank you all and hope that you all enjoyed it. So, could we stand as we bring a close to our service? Huh? Every Wednesday. Every Wednesday we will be here for prayer, whoever comes. Okay? I saw one weary, sad and torn, with eager steps press on the way, who long the hallowed cross had borne, still looking for the promised day. While many a line of grief and care upon his brow was furrowed, dear, I asked what brought his spirits up. Oh, they said he, the blessed hope. And one I saw with sword and shield, who boldly braved the world's cold ground and fought on kneeling on the field to win an everlasting crown. The one with toil oppressed by foe, no murmur from his heart arose. I asked what brought his spirits up. Oh, they said he, the blessed hope. And there was one who left behind the cherished friends of early years, and on a pleasure wealth resigned to tread the path bedewed with tears. Through trials deep and conflicts so, yet still a smile of joy he wore. I asked what brought his spirits up. Oh, they said he, the blessed hope. While pilgrims here we journey on, in this dark veil of sin and gloom, through tribulation, hate and scorn, or through the portals of the tomb, till our returning King shall come to take his exiles captives home. Oh, what can buoy the spirits up? This is alone the blessed hope. Amen. Sister Penny, could you close us in prayer, please? Amen. Yes. Amen. Amen. Okay. All right. Once again, I thank you all. Thank you, Sister Richens, for that piece of history and for all who partake. Thank you, Elder.